we all know we cannot have this summit for democracy today without going to the birthplace of democracy. Dear Prime Minister Mitsotakis, thank you for joining us from Athens, where democracy was established more than 2,500 years ago. So, Kyriakos, good to have you with us. You have the floor.
Thank you, Ursula, Secretary Blinken, ladies and gentlemen. I am indeed joining you today from Athens, the birthplace of democracy, in what is a very important year for Greece. We're celebrating the 200th anniversary of the beginning of our fight for independence from Ottoman rule, an uprising which, against all odds, led to the establishment of a free and democratic Greece. We're all gathered here today because of our belief that at its core, democracy is government of the people, by the people, for the people. And as President Biden said, we must not take democracy for granted. After all, the threats we face from tyrants and autocrats are not new. And allow me, dear Ursula, as I am indeed speaking from the birthplace of democracy, a very quick historical reference. Democratic Athens also faced threats, not just external threats from aggressive autocratic states, but also internal threats from populist leaders who sought to overthrow the people's government in favor of other forms of government. The autocrat was a tyrant, or tyrannos in Greek, but the pandering populist politician who offered two easy solutions to hard problems was a demagogue, or a demagogos. And Athenians quickly recognized and rejected those with a taste for tyranny and demagoguery, primarily because they were very well educated as citizens, choosing their leaders, holding them into account, serving as jurors, actively engaging in political discourse. And they set the two main institutional pillars of every functioning democracy: equality before the law, what we call isonomia, and equal right to public speech, what we call in Greek isigoria, the equivalent today being the rule of law. And freedom of speech. Then, as now, the answer to those twin threats was found in robust public institutions, the promotion and protection of strong social norms, and the building of resources capable of ensuring the delivery of sustainable material welfare for every citizen. And then, as now, leaders were institutionally and socially accountable. They were subject to strict legal review, they were punished if they erred, and they were expected to exemplify in their personal conduct democratic ideals, the democratic ideas of liberty, equality, but also self-control. So the lessons from antiquity is that democracy can be resilient even when threatened and capable of self-correcting when necessary. And a thriving democracy requires institutions that are well-designed, flexible, and robust. But it also necessitates that our social norms are strengthened through education and the good use of technology as an instrument for promoting civic dialogue and tolerance, not as a tool that reinforces prejudices, promotes disinformation, and appeals to the darkest instincts of human nature. Our government in Greece has created a website, gov.gr, which in my mind is a great example of how technology can make the interaction between the state, businesses, and citizens seamless, thus eliminating bureaucracy and tackling corruption in the process. But at the end of the day, dear Ursula, the most important intangible asset of any democracy is trust. Trust in leaders to work for the good of the people and deliver real results, good jobs, good public services, an environment that fights discrimination and fosters inclusiveness. Democratic governments need to be present when they are most required. And that is exactly what Europe did when we set up the Recovery and Resilience Fund to address the consequences of a devastating pandemic. And we need to trust our institutions to hold the power of elected officials in check and to ensure that they actually leave office when they lose elections. After all, this is the most basic litmus test of a well-functioning democracy. And most importantly, we need to trust each other and to understand that we can all be better off if at least sometimes we prioritize the common good over our narrow self-interest. And it is this balance between rights and responsibilities that is at the heart of all thriving democracies. After all, and let me conclude by the words of Pericles, he was right when he said that even if a private man does well, he will be ruined if his country comes to ruin. Whereas if he faces bad luck in a flourishing commonwealth, he shall much more easily be preserved. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you for Jakob for this inspirational message and explaining us the source and the history of rule of law and free speech. And I love the way you really emphasize democracy can be resilient.